Hello everyone, I think we're live. Great, and this is exciting. Welcome to Chateau Morris again for breakfast at Timothy's, back by popular demand. I know I'm surprised. We've got a couple of people joined us. Let us know in the comments if you're here. I managed to get Oh, Jamie's here. Great. Hi, Jamie. I managed to get my computer working this time. If you remember last time, I had a nightmare because it wouldn't work. Hi, Melissa. Morning. Yes, I'm pleased that we're on computer. So I'm just working out where all the comments are. I forgot to get the titles music up. It's terrible. Just a second. Full battery state. Yeah, I do actually have. I've charged my phone overnight and we're on 94%. Last week we were on we were on like 15% or something when I started, 18%, which is why it cut out so prematurely, only 17 minutes in, where I had so much more to say and like we were just plunging the coffee. So we're going to revisit that moment today because I know a lot of you were slightly traumatized and left in suspense about what was happening there. So let me just see if I can get the get this working. Oh no, it's like full of adverts and stuff. Shh. Come on. Right. Okay, ready. Timothy's. Oh, great. I think I got it this time. Last time I jumped a bit early. Anyway, right. So we're back on. Now I've got I made a list this time of like stuff to talk about. Just a couple of updates from last week while we wait for people to join. Found out so the egg scooper thing came from a Tupperware party, which is possibly one of the most like middle class 90s 80s 90s things you could possibly get, like a Tupperware party, which I think was basically where loads of mums would like get together and like buy Tupperware. I don't know if it was a bit like, you have like your Able representative. I think there'd be like a mum who was like the Tupperware representative. And I think I kind of remember going to one, but the kids were in another room and just like play. But also, something else apparently came from a Tupperware party, as a freebie, I think, was this thing. Now, this isn't my chosen posh object of the week. But I don't know if anyone can try and guess or knows what this is. Just hold it up. Kind of looks like a toothbrush without the bristles. Any guesses? Not seeing anything in the comments. So it's actually an orange peeler. So if you get like a proper orange, you can use it to like. I'm not going to do it because I don't want to eat this, but you can use it to break into the skin and peel your orange. Oh, there are comments. It's just not scrolling down. Sorry, everyone. Oh, wow. Hi, Matt. Hi, David. Hi, Alan. Hi, Susan. Joe. Jamie again. Melissa is traumatized about the plunging coffee, like being cut off at the end. It's all right. We'll fix that. I don't. Matt, I don't think Tupperware parties are upper class. It's definitely like middle class. Melissa says she has a gold, yellow gold one, and Jamie's seen that before. Jamie's also actually quite posh, but he just like hides it by being edgy. But anyway, so I don't really like oranges, like big ones. I tend to just eat like the small, like Satsuma tangerine, clementine things. So anyway, but we've got our grapefruit. I'm not gonna prepare it this time on camera because we did it last time. It's really nice, it's not auto-scrolling. great. What else do we have? Oh, update on the egg cups. Apparently these are from There's two of them. It's from the Canary Islands. I think my parents were on holiday there, and they picked them up there. So I know Matt Parker, Matt and Owen Parker, goes to the Canary Islands sometimes. So I don't know whether they've seen these before. Right. So also, I was told last week by my mother that I twitch my nose quite a lot. So I'm going to try not to do that this week. Right. So what have we got? Something in the oven. I don't know if you can see, maybe on the timer, you can't see, but it's got 1 minute left. So that'll ping in a minute and we'll see what's in the oven. Great. Now, what else do we have? Coffee. Gonna make coffee again. I kind of didn't quite show you this last time, but this is one of the advantages of being on my computer is I've got my webcam. So I could just move it like a camera. You can see the kettle lights up blue, which I said is one of the many things I like about it. So anyway, so that's the coffee, which will be plunging in a little bit. Morning, Chris. Oh, Matt says which island? Oh, I can't remember. I think it was is Fuerteventura one of the islands, or is that somewhere from parts of the Caribbean? I'm not sure. The ping is going. This is very exciting. So I'm gonna do this. See if I can angle it so you can see. We're going into this oven. So if for those of you who like saw the preview post late last night, this is what was being prepared. Oh, I think they're done. Look at this, almost maybe slightly overdone, but not quite. So we've got a whole load of cinnamon rolls baked by Mother of Morris last night. She was, I think she's quite excited by the whole thing. And I think she suffers from, not suffers, but has this affliction, which I also have, of kind of reflexive hospitality. So I don't know if you ever, been to someone's house and they kind of constantly offer you cups of tea. But I find I have this, if someone comes to my house, I'm like, I need to look after this person. I'm like, do you want tea? Do you want coffee? Can I get you any food? And then I also feel slightly offended if they say no, which is obviously completely perverse because hospitality is meant to be about the other person and what they want and looking after them. And it's not about my desire to be able to exercise my hospitality, but nevertheless, some part of me still somehow feels offended, and I think my mum has a similar thing. And so, with the whole breakfast activity thing, she's very on board, and she's like, "Oh yeah, let's do some baking," and suggesting ideas. And she's actually she helped me find, come up with the posh object of this week. So I'm just checking the comments again. Amy was right with the cinnamon buns. Very good, Amy. Well done. And Deborah says she just had scrambled eggs and tomatoes for breakfast. Wasn't as impressive as one of your weekly weekend breakfasts. Well, it wouldn't be, would it, Deborah? So if anyone else wants to let me know in the comments what they've been having for breakfast, I'm sure other people will enjoy reading that. I don't really care. Jokes, jokes. So right. I thought that's just one big one. Oh yeah, no, it is, I should say. It is like multiple. So in fact, if I take you over here, because there's something else I want to show you. Right, so this is the cinnamon rolls, which you break apart. It's sort of like tear and share kind of thing. But also, if I show you over the oven, try not to melt the cable. Another preview into middle class posh life. It's a pizza stone. Well, I don't. Someone out there probably has a pizza. You probably got one for your wedding or something like that. It's the kind of thing you will get for people for weddings. But yeah, so let me know in the comments if you have a pizza stone so we can out you as also posh. But yeah, apparently it helps the bottom to be properly baked. Welcome Emily, Josh, Tim Ellis. Good to see you all. What was I doing? Oh, so yeah, posh object of the week. Right, here we go. So, got this like nice little jug, which isn't really thick, but we've got all these little things inside. And if I show you one, the colours aren't particularly significant, but it's like a little kind of thing with prongs or tines, if you, you're into technical cutlery lingo. So yeah, what do you think this is for? Let me know in the comments. They're all the same. There's like white, we've got white, green and pink. If I'm honest, I'm not a massive fan of these shades of color. I think they look a bit kind of like off, but anyway, that's a matter. But yeah, let me know in the comments what you think they might be. It's not a grapefruit fork. Matt Parker says, is it a corn on the cob fork? In fact, I'll show you, Matt, because it's not those either. We do have those though. In a way that's a very, very like Tim Morris kind of styly. We've got a drawer that's full of like little, like old butter tubs, like compartments for different things. And this is the one for sweet corn on the cob thing. So we've got yellow ones and green ones. So these like screw in. And then we've also got some brown stubby wooden fork ones. I'm not sure we've ever used these, but I think they, you know, exist from the days before plastic. So that's what, this is a corn on the cob fork. And that is whatever this thing is. So Matt, I have no idea why you think they're in any way similar, because they're clearly quite different. But there we go. Corn on the cob jug. Oh, did I say jug? Yeah, so it's in a jug, not a mug. Sorry, Melissa. Amy Parker says her mum also has a drawer full of butter tubs and corn on the cob forks. I'll give you a clue. It apparently came with this, like stainless steel kind of little dish thing. I don't know if that gives you any clue. I think this kind of looks like the thing they have in like Casualty for putting people's organs in once they've removed them in, you know, theatre. But I don't think that's what it's for. Maybe it's not an image to put in your heads at breakfast time. Not pasta forks. Well, that's an interesting idea. And it's funny you should say pasta, because there's actually an Italian link here. So this jug was a gift from me to my parents, or possibly specifically my mum, from, I bought it in Sorrento in Italy. And to get particularly posh, I was in Sorrento in Italy for a Latin trip with my Latin class. I should point out at this point, I did go to a comprehensive school, but it's a comprehensive school in quite like a posh area, and it still taught Latin, which was great fun. So we had a GCSE Latin classes, had a trip to Italy. I went to Rome and then went to Sorrento, which is in Naples, and did like Pompeii and Vesuvius and stuff like that. And so I brought this back from Italy. So we had some other suggestions. Fondue forks. No, we do have some fondue forks. They're in the other room, so I'll try and get those for next week, because I don't want to like abandon the camera for ages. Fondue forks would be much longer, because like, yeah, if you imagine you've got your thing of cheese and you're like going in, you're gonna like, the cheese will be up to your elbow with something this long. So, but it's, I get where you're coming from, it's similar. Nothing to do with eggs, as Deborah said. It's not surgery, that was just my random imagination about this dish. you didn't say it. Antipasti forks, that's a nice guess, Jay. That would be it. I don't think that's a thing, actually. Or maybe is that a thing that you have, Jamie? I think they would be kind of quite good for antipasti. And actually, you're not a million miles away. Melissa says, Caecilius est in atrium, which I think is from the Cambridge Latin course. There's basically like one Latin course that anyone in school who learns Latin does, which is Cambridge Latin course. But my school, we have this other one called Ecce Romani, which is like really, really old. Like my aunts have done Ecce Romani, which basically means like, look Romans, or like, see, there's like Romans. So I didn't have the joys of Caecilius. We had like Marcus and Cornelia and stuff. Camembert forks, another a good guess. Salad forks, not correct. Salad is perhaps a bit warmer than camembert, ironically, because obviously not in real life. I need to pour this coffee. Right, I think I might give you a clue. Oh, something else I didn't show you last week, which is quite nice. I've got this coffee tin from Dam Egberts, which is, I think, several hundred years old. Well, like, yeah, from the time my parents got married. Olive forks. Ooh, olive is kind of warmer. In the movie in the right direction. Morning, Alicia. So, yeah, this is the coffee tin that we have. Normal coffee and decaf coffee. Obviously, real coffee. None of this fake, whatever this is. So I'll just put this in here. What other guesses have we got? Cured meat forks. It's basically the same as antipasti, isn't it, Jamie? I think you're trying to guess. I'm not that, like, I know I can be, but I'm not being that kind of specific. It is posh coffee. Right, add the water. I can't believe how, like, this is, time's flown, and, like, it's 20 past, and we've not made much progress. And I think my dad wants to get into the kitchen at 5:30 to make his breakfast. So we'll crack on. Now, something else, and I think this will delight some of you. So for breakfast today, I thought I'd do, as well as the, like, I've got my cereal, by the way, I should say. I think controversially, I'm going to go for fruit and fibre today, even though it's like a Sunday, because tomorrow's a bank holiday. So I have fruit and fibre today. I'm going to treat myself to, like, fancy cereal tomorrow, which is quite nice. Morning, Josh. Pastry forks. No, that's, so olive forks is the closest we've had so far. I think, shall I put you out of your misery? They're actually pickle forks. Go figure. So you like pickles as in gherkins. So I think the idea is you put your gherkins in this, like, stainless steel operating theatre organ dish. And I can't even get that on camera. There we go. And then you can all, like, get your... Because to be fair, they are quite awkward. Because they're round and they're in, like, vinegar. They're quite wet and slippery. And you have a job to, like, pin them down. So I think they are... You might think it is a superfluous... posh object, but you might find actually that it's quite a useful thing in your life if you consume pickles, which I do actually. I quite like gherkins. So the other thing I'm doing for breakfast today is the coffee's just brewing. We'll plunge that maybe at the end, and I thought I'd have some smashed avocado toast, which is very, I think that's millennial or middle class. Now I'll just grab the avocado. It's probably both, actually, isn't it? Millennial and middle class. Now, I know lots of you will have always struggled to get avocados out of their shell because it is like a challenge. But what you were lacking, and Melissa says they're snail forks, which I could see as well, they'd be quite good for. But, you know, like if you're French and stuff. Joe's saying that I'm allowed chocolate both today and tomorrow because it's bank holiday. I'll have to think about it. So I know some of you will have often struggled with getting avocados out of their skin. It's like a challenge we all face in life. But what you didn't realize you needed until now was an avocado knife. How brilliant is this? And like, it's, I don't know if you could, just in case it wasn't obvious, the handle is meant to look like an avocado. So you can see, obviously, it's like being cut in half. But if it was the full, oh, I'm going to get this right way around. No, that way around. It was right. Oh, no. Yeah. If you imagine it had like the top that's kind of pe- oh, in fact, I've got a hole one here. That's easier. You can see they're kind of like the same shape, maybe slightly elongated, but you've got to give them a bit of like flexibility. Nearly dropped it. so Deborah is saying she doesn't like avocados. Avocados used to be the one thing that I didn't eat. I'm like not a fussy eater really at all, but I used to think they're really slimy and horrible. But somehow I like started eating them. So the way this works, I think, is you can slide it in, and because it's got this kink on the end, you could then like just work it loose. Da-da-da. And I haven't really thought this through because I've not got anything to put it in. But there we go. Anyway, so I'll take my word for it, it's kind of loose. And I have avocado all over my arm. But there we go. And that's been a pretty good job, I think. I think I'm going to put it back in because until I can get a plate out. now. yeah, in case you wanted to get your own avocado knife, and this isn't a sponsorship deal, but this is from Lakeland, which is where like lots of very posh middle class kitchen objects come from. So if you want to up your posh game, then Lakeland's your place. Yeah, I will not take too long because otherwise it will go brown. Right, so now, the last thing before I plunge the coffee and then work out how to finish this, because I can't just have my battery die like last time. Oh, it's got a button. That's all right. I'll just say goodbye to me. I did promise on the original advert that we'd have brioche banter Bible, and I didn't get around to the Bible. So I was going to share a kind of thought that. So in our Sunday services, we'd be going through the Jesus Storybook Bible and kind of working through the Bible sort of story in overview. People say I'm mad, and Steve's laughing about Lakeland. It's funny that Lakeland's like in the north, or that originates in the north, because like you think it would be like somewhere that come from like Surrey or something like that. But the original Lakeland is in Windermere. If you've been to the station, like there's a Lakeland like behind the station car park, and I think that's the original one, also hence the name Lakeland. But then I guess you do get like Booths in the north. In fact, that is like Lakeland is next to Booths, I think. It's like, yeah. So maybe that makes sense. so we've I've lost my train of thought. Right, so last week we were in the story of like the calling of Abraham, and this week we're in the story of Isaac and what happened to him or didn't happen to him, as the story goes. But I was just going to share something that I noticed a while back in a completely unrelated sermon before lockdown. And Steve mentioned this bit, and I was just sitting in the service reading it, not quite listening to what he was saying at the time. Sorry, Steve. but it's the Genesis 15. And it's kind of, you've had Abraham's been called by God to kind of go. He says, like, go, and Abraham goes, Genesis 12. And then some other stuff happens. And then it kind of gets to this point where Abraham says, after these things, this is Genesis 15. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Fear not, Abraham. I'm your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abraham said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless. And the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abraham said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. So it's kind of Abraham's reached this sort of, it's not quite a midlife crisis, but he's really very worldly successful, very rich, and he's got like all this stuff. But you kind of sense this like disappointment and kind of dissatisfaction with where he's ended up in life. And obviously, like, we feel for him because being able to pass on your stuff to your children, having children was really significant for the culture, and I suppose still is today, and being able to pass on your inheritance to your children. And so Abraham's at this kind of like, kind of, it's not kind of, yeah, his life's very good, but he's got this kind of lingering disappointment and uncertainty. And so if we carry on, And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, this man shall not be your heir, your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, look towards heaven and number the stars if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. And I think I was reading this and thinking, I noticed something I've not really seen before. And I think often at this point, we get really excited about this kind of, it's this big kind of cinematic moment in Bible history where you've got this kind of promise, number the stars, if you're able to number them, so shall your offspring be. Like God is promising to have this great nation through Abraham, which is kind of similar to what he says in Genesis 12 when he calls them first, but not quite the same. And so I think always we're like, yeah, like, come on, this is like the kind of start of the nation of Israel and all that God is doing through calling his people together. But I kind of missed just before that this little detail where it says, and he brought him outside and said, look towards heaven and number the stars. And I just love, it's kind of so like perfect and almost like how this would happen in a film, how you write this. And I really love the way it shows the father heart of God. This is exactly the kind of thing you'd have like a father-son moment in the film and they're like out camping in a tent, because you know, Abraham lived in a tent. And you know, the son's like not sure about something. And his dad would like, say, come on, son, like they go outside and he'd point at the stars and make some kind of grand like, tell some story or be kind of reassuring and like or remind me of the bit in Lion King where Simba sees this vision of Mufasa in the sky. He sort of watched that having read this and thought, oh, maybe that's similar, and it's awful. He's like, Mufasa's like, oh, like, you, what are you doing, like, remember who you are, and like it's not encouraging at all. And then he like just goes and Simba's like, father, where are you? Whereas here I just love the kind of kindness and gentleness of God in that he takes Abraham like he would take a little child and he points him up at the sky, which is such a kind of naturally human thing to do if you've ever been out camping, especially in the countryside, in the wilderness where it's dark enough to see the stars. He says, look at the stars, like you, and gives him something he can remember. Like you'd see the stars every night back then because there wasn't light pollution for big cities. And so every evening, every night, Abraham would see the stars and be able to remember that. And what I really love is I can imagine, and I don't think this is how it happened in the Bible, but thinking about the story we have of Isaac coming up today, like no spoilers, but you could almost imagine a moment where like Isaac kind of twigs what might be going on. And is, you know, we see this moment, this terrible moment where he says, behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And like, we all know the answer is like, you know, terrifying. But you could almost imagine, Abraham doing the same thing for Isaac, like maybe the night before they're like camping out before they go up the mountain, and like Isaac's kind of twigs what's about to happen perhaps, and he says like, yeah, am I going to be all right or something, and Abraham takes him out of the tent and says anyway, you can finish the story. Can't be, I didn't mean to. Anyway, here is plunging the coffee and what I was going to say last week and would have said this week if I hadn't started crying. I really love, it's so funny that you finish on, but I really, really love the way that this handle fits into the top of the coffee just really nicely. I don't know. It's just like a really neat little thing, so, which is what I was going to say last week, but we were cut off prematurely by the battery dying. But anyway, so... thanks for joining, and I'll start crying again. I'll see you next week.